Hey Riv, how's it going? Thanks for joining us today. My name's TJ. I'm part of the student ministries team here. And I just got to say, it's great to be with you again today. And so just at the beginning here, want to point out rivchurch.com/live. That's a great resource for you. Great place to get connected. Great place to drop off prayer requests, get some Riv Kids materials, and just really in general, get connected with what we're doing here at Riv. So go check out rivchurch.com/live. Now, join us for some worship with this band, awesome band, Westside Junction.
Hey, Riv, so glad that we get to be together today and do some worshiping together. I wonder if you would just take a second and pray with me before we get started. Father, thank you that you are the God of everything that we know and understand, and I'm just so grateful that you're also the God of everything that we don't know and don't understand. And God, we just come before you today. We lay our burdens and we lay our thanks before you at your altar. And we just thank you that we can trust you to have that all in your hands. We pray that you'll teach us well today, that your Holy Spirit will make your word clear to us. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Oh, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. How many of you have heard that prayer before? That's called the Lord's Prayer. In the church I attended growing up, we recited that prayer word for word at every single weekend service. I will never forget it. The problem was I didn't understand a word of it when I was a kid. It wasn't the church's fault at all. I didn't even know what half of the words meant. I didn't really know what was going on in the church. I don't know what hallowed or trespass, or I didn't know that wasn't part of my vocabulary at the time. But that was my first understanding of what prayer was. It was this group of people repeating together a series of words that were written in advance. Maybe you had a similar introduction to prayer. Fast forward to high school, that's when I heard the gospel for the first time and understood it for the first time, and I became a Christian. I joined this small group Bible study, and the way those high school kids prayed was completely new to me. Only one person prayed at a time, and it seemed like they were just kind of just riffing their thoughts. It was very informal, conversational, very personal. It was kind of like, hey, God, you know, thanks for being awesome. Tell Jesus hi for me. You know, it was kind of this, and it took some getting used to because it was so different from my earlier prayer experiences growing up. What are some of the first memories maybe you have when it comes to prayer? Some people talk about their mom or their dad, or maybe their grandparents would pray for them before they went to bed every night or at the dinner table. I did not have that experience. How did you learn about prayer? Who taught you? What were your early prayers like in terms of the format and the content of your prayers? Today, I want to talk about the relationship between prayer and the Bible. Something I never really thought about until I was a college student. Our tendency, I think, is to think of prayer and Bible reading as two completely separate endeavors. I certainly thought that way for a long time. The goal for our time is to see how prayer and reading the Bible are actually intertwined, and to give us some practical tools to help us grow in prayer through the Bible, and to help us grow in the Bible through prayer. How can we allow the truth of God's word to shape the language and content of our prayers? As an example, let's use Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 through 12 as the text to open our time in prayer together here today. We won't have the words on the screen. I just want us to hear God's truth as a prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that those listening today may be filled with the knowledge of your will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, so that we may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to your glorious might. Amen. You know, there's something powerful about praying God's word for other people because you know you are praying truth when you pray God's word. These are the very words of God. And I think there's something also powerful about having God's word prayed for you for the same reason. God's truth is here. So let's jump in. If you have your Bible with you, open up to Luke chapter 11. We'll have the verses up on the screen behind me as well here. And also, you may want to grab, if you can maybe have a notepad or on your iPad or phone or something, a way to take some notes. We're going to be doing a couple of little kind of practical times here during this message as well. You may want to have something handy for that. Luke chapter 11, verse 1 says this. He, that's Jesus, was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray. I just love the disciples. Very practical, very helpful. Lord, teach us to pray, just as John also taught his disciples. Jesus said to them, whenever you pray, say, Father, your name be honored as holy. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves also forgive everyone in debt to us, and do not bring us into temptation. Now, right away, the first thing I notice in this passage is that Jesus prayed a lot. I mean, like maybe all the time, which is interesting because Jesus was and is and always has been, always will be God himself. And yet in his humanity, he prayed all the time to his heavenly Father. Leading up to this moment in Luke chapter 11, Jesus is on the move. If you go back to chapter 10, he sends out 72 of his followers in pairs to go out and tell people about Jesus. And then he debriefs with all of them when they return. Then he shares the parable of the Good Samaritan, which is one of the most amazing teachings, not just in the Bible, but anywhere ever. And then he visits Mary and Martha. It's a very full and fast-paced life that Jesus has. And so now he wants to pray. And he goes off to his sort of go-to place, right? Maybe it's up on Mount Arbel on the mountainside or out in a boat or by the Sea of Galilee. And he is praying. Now, we don't know exactly what happened here, but the way I picture it is his disciples are watching from a distance as Jesus is praying, and they're waiting. Like, you think he's done yet? Why is he taking so long? Because I've got questions about that Good Samaritan thing and his conversation with Mary and Martha, and don't interrupt him. He hates being interrupted, you know, kind of a thing. So finally, one of them's like, all right, I got it. Let's ask him about prayer. He loves talking about that. And it's like, hey, Jesus. And they're like, no, Matthew, he likes being called Lord. Call him Lord. All right, Lord, teach us how to pray. And Jesus is like, sure. And he shares with them what we now call the Lord's Prayer. Maybe you've heard it called the Our Father. Now, for a long time, I always thought, well, Jesus just made up this prayer on the spot. And in a sense, maybe that's true. But if you dig a little deeper, what you see is that underneath the prayer that Jesus offers here, it's filled with Old Testament references and truth. In fact, the first word of the prayer is Father, or maybe you're more familiar with the version in Matthew 6, Our Father is the way it starts. Now, why does he start there? Well, if you go all the way back to Isaiah chapter 63, in verse 16, it says this, yet you are our Father. Even though Abraham does not know us and Israel does not recognize us, you, Lord, are our Father. Your name is our Redeemer from ancient times. To teach his disciples how to pray, Jesus reaches back for the truth and language from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. The words our Father are repeated twice by Isaiah in that 16th verse of chapter 63. They were written during a time when God's people, the Jews, had strayed far from God, so much so that Isaiah says, Abraham wouldn't even know you. Israel wouldn't even recognize you. And yet, Isaiah says, you are our Father, still, always. Lesson number one from Jesus. When you pray, regardless of what's going on in your heart or how far you may have strayed from following Jesus in your life, start by remembering who God is. He's our Father. We are his children, still, always. Father, your name be honored as holy, he says. Now that language is everywhere in the Bible. If you've done any Bible reading, you know there's tons of examples of people lifting up the name of God, blessing the name of God, honoring his name as holy. In fact, right here in this same verse, Isaiah 63:16, Look at the second half of the verse. Yet you are our father, even though Abraham does not know us and Israel does not recognize us. You, Lord, are our father. Your name is our Redeemer from ancient times. And again, the context here in Isaiah 63, it's very much about how God's people have strayed far from him and God's resulting grief and anger and wrath. And yet Isaiah says, even though it doesn't seem to be true, we honor your name as holy. We call you Father twice. And then we say, your name is our Redeemer from ancient times. A Redeemer is one who repays, one who saves. The one we pray to, Isaiah says, our Father is also our Savior. He always has been from the ancient of times, from the beginning of days, right? This has always been who God is, and it will always be who he is. I love how Jesus, by the way, is essentially talking about himself here. Redeemer is one of Jesus's own titles. He is the Savior, the Redeemer. There's just so much baked into the first seven words of Jesus's answer to the question or to the teach us to pray request on the part of his disciples. He's encouraging his disciples to use the truth and language of the Bible as the content of their prayer, and specifically begin by reminding yourselves of who God is. Before you ask for God's provision, which is important, before you confess your sins and ask for forgiveness, which is important, before you appeal to God for help in temptation, remember that God is Dad. His name is to be honored as holy. Now, I don't want to become too fixated on this one verse in Isaiah 63. That's just one example. I could have chosen dozens of others. In fact, if you want to dive a little deeper, you can head over to rivchurch.com/live. I've included a graphic there that shows an additional 40-ish Old Testament verses that share in the language and themes of Jesus's Lord's Prayer here in Luke 11. It would make a great study on your own time or maybe with your life group, whatever you might want to do there. The point is that Jesus made a regular practice of praying the truth of God's word. And there are hundreds of examples right from the Bible of ways to keep this idea of lifting up God's name. He said to them, whenever you pray, say, Father, your name be honored as holy, your kingdom come, give us each day our daily bread. Now, there's lots of ways to think about praying for God to provide, to give this daily bread. What's he talking about there? Well, he could very literally be talking about bread or food, daily provision, or maybe shelter. God, we need a car. We need rent money. Or I'm praying for this family. They need parents. They need somebody to provide for them, right? Or it could be more of a metaphorical prayer, right? Jesus, you know, said about himself, I am the bread of life. His word is referred to as bread. You know, the prayer could be, God, sustain me today. Sustain my mind. Sustain my heart. Give me the truth of your word that I need today. Let's take a few moments. I'm going to give you maybe 30 seconds to just process this idea and maybe pray this prayer for yourself or for others. I'm going to give you a couple of questions, and then we'll just have a little time of reflection. This is where you may want to write down some notes. I'm going to write some notes here for myself. What has God provided for you already? What is the bread that he has already given you that you are thankful for? What do you need today, or maybe this week, or soon, that you would like to ask him for? And who else can we pray for in that same way? So take a few seconds to just kind of reflect on those questions, make a couple notes, and then we'll keep going. You know, one of the first things I wrote down here was salvation. Thank you for providing yourself for me, Lord. Verse 4 here of Luke 11 says, "And forgive us our sins, for we ourselves also forgive everyone in debt to us." So when I was in college, I was part of this Wednesday morning prayer group at my church. And there was like 20-ish people in this group that met at 5:45 a.m. every Wednesday morning to pray. It was really early as a college student or as any human. It would be early for anybody, I think. And in this group, the person who led it used the Lord's Prayer as sort of our prayer template each week. And I'll never forget the first week I showed up at this prayer group, and we got to this verse. And one by one, the people in this room, they started praying these prayers of confession, like out loud, like the big ones. I mean, they weren't just like praying for like, you know, the things that we all like, yeah, somebody cut me off and I kind of got mad like we all do. They were praying like for significant sin issues in their life, for God to heal them, for they were just confessing. And my eyes, I remember just thinking, are they going to ask me to do that? It's my first day here. And I was like, maybe I should leave, you know. But the more I thought about it, the more I realized, why not? Is hiding our sin really helping us? I mean, God knows all this stuff anyway. The truth shall set you free, right? Now, we're not going to do that necessarily today publicly. Maybe with your family or whoever you're watching the service with, you want to share a little bit of kind of what's going on in your heart. But again, let's take a couple of moments for some time of personal confession. You may want to, again, write some notes down or just use this time to reflect and pray and ask for God's forgiveness. In what ways have you been sinning that you want to ask for God's forgiveness? Who has sinned against you that you would like to choose to forgive? Take a couple seconds with those questions as well. The next part of verse 4 says this, "And do not bring us into temptation." We'll use this last time of reflection just to ask ourselves this question and pray that God with his Spirit would reveal to us, what areas of temptation do you face? And where can you ask for God's protection to help you avoid some of those temptations? Who else can you pray for in this way? This is a great way to pray for your kids, for your friends, for your spouse. What temptations do they face? Lead us not to temptation. We'll have one last time of reflection here. Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus said to them, "Whenever you pray, say, 'Father, your name be honored as holy. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves also forgive everyone in debt to us. And do not bring us into temptation.'" Isn't Jesus just incredible? I mean, I was reading those words. His model for prayer is so simple. It's so easy, but it's so profound, right? Rooted in biblical truth, practical, universal, right? Powerful. It's just amazing. His model there is just such an example for us. Hopefully it'll be useful to you as a framework for maybe a regular rhythm of prayer, application of God's word. And at the same time, hear me now, there's plenty of other ways to pray without involving the Lord's Prayer, right? I mean, just because you haven't been maybe thinking about this passage or whatever doesn't mean you're doing it wrong or whatever. A lot of times we don't have time or space to get ourselves mentally or emotionally organized, even to go through sort of a more orderly process like this. You've got three young kids pulling on you, or two final exams in the morning, or your dad's in the hospital with COVID, or God isn't going, Luke 11, don't forget to use the formula. You know, doesn't work that way, right? Think about all the examples of that in the Bible. The criminal on the cross, he just calls out, aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and save us. Mary and Martha, after Lazarus died, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. The man with the demon-possessed child in the Gospels, he says, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Peter sinking into the Sea of Galilee, Lord, save me, right? There's just sort of this visceral call for help, none of these prayers are particularly articulate or biblical. They're just sincere. It's why I love the rest of this passage in Luke chapter 11, starting in verse 5. Remember, it's the disciples saying, Lord, teach us to pray. He said to them, whenever you pray, say this, just like we talked about, right? And then in verse 5, it says, he also said to them, in other words, he's still teaching them to pray in verse 5. He also said to them, suppose one of you has a friend and goes to him at midnight and says to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread because a friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I don't have anything to offer him. And so this is life, right? Lots of curveballs. You're sleeping. It's late at night. Somebody comes and they want some bread. It's just kind of like this, you know, what do I do here? Sometimes it's day-to-day stuff like that. Very important. Sometimes there's crisis situations. I call those STU prayers. It's suddenly, tragically, urgently, you know, this just something, you know, there's no time to organize your thoughts. It's just, you just react. And so this is Jesus kind of response to those kind of situations. Verse 7, he says, then, after this person goes and asks his friend for help, then the person that's on the other side of the door, he will answer from inside and say, don't bother me. The door is already locked and my children and I have gone to bed. I can't get up to give you anything. Now, whenever you read one of these parables, it's always useful to ask, which one of the people in the parable is God and which one is me? And in case you missed it, in this parable, God is the guy who can't be bothered with your request because he's sleeping, okay? So you're the other person who needs the bread. Verse 8, I tell you, even though he won't get up and give him anything because he is a friend, yet because of his friend's shameless boldness, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. Now, that's an interesting phrase to me, as much as he needs. I wonder what that was. Did he give him 3 loaves of bread, or was it something completely different, which was as much as he needed? We don't know what exactly that means. Then this part's more familiar. Verse 9, Jesus says, so I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you, for everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks the door will be opened. What father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? I love that last part. I wonder how many people have turned to God in a time of need and said, God, I need 3 loaves of bread. And they ended up becoming Christians and receiving the Holy Spirit instead, right? As a part of that process. How often do we ask and seek and knock, waiting for God to give us what we think we need? And God's answer is to remind us that we already have him and he's everything that we need. Now, remember what we talked about, our goal from the beginning is this question: how can we allow the truth of the Bible to shape the language and the content of our prayers? And I think we've seen here, it's important to tap into the wisdom of the Bible as you pray. You don't have to do it every time. It's not a rule. It's just a good practice to pray using the truth of God's word. Jesus gave us some good examples in the Lord's Prayer to remember who God is, the names of God that are found in his word, to ask for his provision, his forgiveness, and his protection. And the Bible contains all kinds of other kinds of prayer, prayers of joy, prayers of lament. Go back, we'll be looking into the Psalms here in a couple weeks. We're gonna be looking at different parts of the scripture, prayers for others to get saved. There's just so much relevance here in the scripture. Pray the truth of the Bible for yourself. As you're reading along the Bible, sometimes you may wanna stop and just say, I need to pray that for me right now. Lord, help me to follow this command, to trust this promise, to believe this truth. Pray these truths for your spouse, for your kids. You know, my wife has specific verses that she has prayed for each of our boys since way back when they were babies. You're going to see an example here of that in a moment. And then there are also times when things are chaotic and frazzled and we cry out to God. And a lot of times, if we're honest, when we do those prayers, which are so important, it does feel like he's sleeping. It's like, God, are you there? I keep knocking, I'm seeking. When we start banging on the door, right? The egg that we ask for, sometimes it's like, is that really a scorpion or an egg, right? And what's Jesus's challenge to us? Shameless boldness is the phrase he used. Be persistent, keep knocking. You may ask for 3 loaves of bread and receive the Holy Spirit instead. Everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be open. And no matter what kind of prayer you're praying, whether it's this more ordered, measured kind of, you know, intentional prayer time or just a cry for help in the midst of some chaos, always, always remember who God is. He is our Father. He is our Redeemer from the Ancient of Times. He is good. He knows what you need, right? Remember back at the beginning of our message here when we prayed from Colossians chapter 1 to open our time together. That's actually the verse that my wife prayed for our youngest son, Luke, all the way back since he was a baby. And when I was telling her about the sermon this week, she was sharing with me how as she's looked back, it's been so encouraging to her to see how God over time has answered this prayer in Luke's life. And it's been very reassuring for her. And so let's hear those words one more time to close our time in prayer today. And then this might be a verse for you to consider praying for yourself, for your spouse, your kids, for other people you care about. Let's pray. This is Colossians chapter 1 again, starting in verse 9. For this reason also, since the day we heard this, we haven't stopped praying for you. We are asking, this is our request, Lord, that we may be filled with the knowledge of your will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, so that we may walk worthy of you, Lord, fully pleasing you, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in our knowledge of you, being strengthened with all power according to your glorious might, so that we may have great endurance and patience, joyfully giving thanks to you, our Heavenly Father. You who have enabled us to share in the inheritance of the saints, you have rescued us, Lord, from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of your Son, Jesus, who you love. Amen. One, two, three.
but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. I love that. Thankful for that song in my own life. Lord, help me believe the truth from that song. Hey, thanks for joining us today. If you'd like to give financially to Riverview, to our mission, which we're always so thankful for, you can set up online giving at rivchurch.com/give, or you can text give to the number that's on the screen. Two easy ways to do that at home. Always, we're so thankful for your generosity. It helps us do what we're called to do, is proclaim the liberating power of the gospel as we grow, serve, and go. And while we're here, we should say, hey, join a life group. If you guys aren't familiar with life groups, we have all kinds of life groups happening around the Lansing area. These groups that we kind of meet in person a lot of times, or some people meet online. They meet in every kind of way really that they can, just to kind of make the environment smaller where we can hear and talk about the message and really kind of, break it down into our lives. A big part of life groups is doing life with one another. And just maybe this is a place where we can pray together. This is a place where we can do some of the confessing. This is a place where we have individuals surrounding us and helping us kind of do the mission of Riverview and proclaim the gospel to one another. I know that my wife and I are part of a life group. And honestly, in the last year, it's been really refreshing meeting with the life group, having these men in my life that can come and just be like a breath of fresh air for us in a season that's just really been hard. I mean, and so that's a big thing that life groups really do. So to get connected to a life group, you can head to rivchurch.com/life groups and get signed up, and maybe we'll find somebody to get you plugged in somewhere near you. So lastly, just a reminder, Riv Kids is happening. So we have a Riv Kids kid, you know, it's like wild to even think that, but it's open. It's open for walkers through pre-K every weekend. We're here to serve you and not just be babysitters, but teach your kid the gospel. And so teach them all about Jesus and their love, just Jesus' love for us. So if you want to register your kid at rivchurch.com/visit, you can do that. It's easy. I'm telling you right now, it's a great experience for your kids. So thanks for joining us online, and we really had fun with you. So thank you.